Okay, so sisters and brothers, to our next keynote speaker. Mr. Stephen Lewis is the co-founder and the co-director of AIDS Free World, an international advocacy organization that exposes injustice, abuse, and inequality, the social ills that underpin and continue to sustain HIV. Stephen Lewis's work with the United Nations spanned more than two decades. He was the United Nations Secretary General's Special Envoy for HIV/AIDS in Africa from June of 2001 until the end of 2006. From 95 to 99, Mr. Lewis was the Deputy Executive Director of UNICEF at the organization's global headquarters in New York. From 84 through 88, he was Canada's ambassador to the United Nations. In addition to his work with AIDS Free World, Mr. Lewis is a professor of distinction at Ryerson University in Toronto and a professor of practice in global governance at the Institute for the Study of International Development at McGill University. He is also the co-founder and the board chair of the Stephen Lewis Foundation. Stephen Lewis is a companion of the Order of Canada, Canada's highest honor for lifetime achievement. He holds 40 honorary doctorates, 38 from Canadian universities, plus degrees from Dartmouth College and John Hopkins University in the United States. But most of all, he's a friend of labor and an ally to CUPE Ontario. Join me in welcoming Stephen Lewis.
Please. That was such a delicious and amiable introduction, and then I come to the podium and it says 3 minutes. And I think to myself, this is a form of sabotage, which I am unused to. I'm absolutely delighted to be here, and it's extraordinary of Candace to be so friendly and generous to a free spirit who loves the trade union movement, and frankly and profoundly, there's no group I prefer to address than trade unionists. The truth is that philosophically we share the same values, and politically we share the same political party, and ideologically, and that to me is most important, I take a particular pride in being in the ethos of a trade union, because CUPE understands more than most that the world of trade unionism goes beyond the particular avenues of collective bargaining, goes beyond questions of salaries and wages and benefits. I do remember with some nostalgia, I was telling the national president, Mark, just a little while ago, and Fred knows this well, that I spent a good chunk of my life in the late 1970s and early 1980s doing arbitrations with the inside and outside workers in Toronto for CUPE, and also for a number of CUPE hospitals doing interest arbitrations. So I have a profound, almost organic relationship with this union. But what really both pleases, gratifies, and stimulates me is the way in which CUPE understands that fighting for social justice takes you beyond the normal parameters of trade union activity. Understanding that there are vulnerable peoples and vulnerable areas through the world, and that CUPE is prepared to mobilize and support those who are struggling for gender equality, for overcoming poverty, for dealing with communicable disease, for generally fighting for social justice in places where human populations are so profoundly vulnerable. It's an elixir of hope to be in the presence of people who understand that. And therefore, I really feel privileged to be able to take a few minutes of your time this morning. I can't tell you how appreciative I am, and so many of my colleagues are, for CUPE's support, both for the Stephen Lewis Foundation, which does, as you probably know, a great deal of work with many, many people fighting and living with HIV and AIDS in Africa, but also supporting so strongly, as has been the case at the national level, the work, and at the provincial level of CUPE in Ontario, of the work of AIDS Free World. And I wanted to tell you a little bit about the work of AIDS Free World this morning, and one particular avenue of interest, because I think unless I'm wrong, I hope I'm not, it will fascinate you. And I hope it will allow you to understand what a tremendous contribution the union is making to change the functioning, the destructive functioning of so much of the international community. AIDS Free World is an advocacy organization. We take on the most contentious issues that exist around questions of disease and poverty and gender. We are unflinching and merciless in our critiques of the establishment. We will give no one any quarter. We are therefore detested by many. We have alienated large parts of the United Nations community. That gives me great pleasure. It's like CUPE taking on a major multinational corporation or one of your employer groups whom privately you can't stand. It's a sense that when you're fighting for social justice, you simply have to take unswerving and committed and principled positions and not retreat, because too much of this world succumbs to the establishment that runs it. And for AIDS Free World, all of the advocacy issues around HIV and AIDS allow us an entry point into other subjects that are particularly volatile and pressing. One of the things we're doing right now, for example, is trying to mobilize the trade union movement internationally as well as nationally and provincially in support of persuading the International Labour Organization, which is a UN agency based in Geneva, to take on the issue of child marriage. And peculiarly enough, the International Labour Organization will not touch child marriage, despite the fact that there are 15 million young girls every year under the age of 18, a significant number of them under the age of 15, who are forced into illegal marriages. They're forced into doing all of the housework and housekeeping that is required by their older and authoritarian spouse. And they are, of course, subject to sexual assault, rape on a daily basis in an illegal marriage. And we're trying to get the International Labour Organization to understand that this is a palpable situation of forced labor, that these young girls trapped in a marriage not of their own choosing under any circumstances are really trapped in one of the most grievous forms of child labor. And we are mobilizing the international trade union movement to put pressure on the International Labor Organization, of which the trade unions are a constituent part, in order to get them to change their policy. And it's terrific to be able to draw upon the trade union movement in that instance. But let me tell you of what we are as AIDS Free World and what you have been supporting. We are engaged in at this very moment in time, which preoccupies us almost on an obsessive basis. One of the issues which has now gripped the international community and about which there is an intense anxiety is, of course, sexual violence. And we have been looking over the course of the last few years, and particularly over the course of the last couple of years, at the way in which sexual violence and sexual assault manifests itself in a variety of circumstance. And without going into the details of how we got there, one of the things that overwhelmed us, astonished us, dismayed us, was the sudden understanding that there is a great deal of sexual violence committed by United Nations peacekeepers who are sent to countries in conflict in order to protect the civilian population. And it seems both bizarre and almost impossible to imagine that the very peacekeepers who are there to protect the civilian population prey upon the civilian population for purposes of sexual gratification, which amounts simply to sexual exploitation and abuse, rape, violence. So we thought we'd best figure out why this was happening and why the United Nations couldn't bring it to an end, because it's been going on in country after country where there are peacekeeping operations for 10, 15, 20, 25 years. And we began to understand as we analyzed it that it was because of something called the Convention on Privileges and Immunities, which was a convention passed by the United Nations back in 1946 intended to protect diplomats in the process of their work, but was never intended to apply to peacekeepers who were engaged in criminal activity like sexual assault. And we therefore decided we would initiate a campaign. We called it the Code Blue campaign. Imagine Code Blue in a hospital setting. We called it the Code Blue campaign to remove immunity for sexual violence committed by United Nations peacekeepers, because the United Nations was so often using the pretext of immunity to say, you can't do anything about these peacekeepers who have engaged in violence. They are immune from prosecution. They're immune from indictment. So we brought together at McGill University in 2014, I guess, in the fall of 2014, we brought together at a workshop for an entire week 17 experts from all over the world who were in conflict countries, who were academics, who were activists, who were on the front lines with the UN and others. And we sat down for a week and we examined with great intensity every single aspect of the convention and its application and of peacekeepers and what we could do about it. And then we decided that at some point in 2015, we would launch our Code Blue campaign. And as we were preparing to do that, which was intended to be in May of 2015, of last year, we became better and better known for taking a stand on the question of sexual exploitation and abuse in peacekeeping operations, and people began leaking material to us. And then something happened which kind of eviscerates the soul. I'm 78 years old. I'm completely in my dotage, as you can see. And I often think that I understand the world. I'm not a sweet innocent. Spent a lot of time in politics and diplomacy. But I want to tell you, I just don't understand the dimensions of some human behavior. And one of the things that came to us in April of 2015 was a report that had been taken by a UNICEF representative and a representative of the United Nations High Commission on Human Rights in the Central African Republic, a country in turmoil with a large number of peacekeepers. And the UNICEF representative and the representative of the Human Rights Commissioner had interviewed 6 little boys, mostly the ages of 8 and 9, living in an internally displaced camp at the airport on the outskirts of the regional capital called Bangui. And the little boys had been sexually assaulted by French peacekeepers who forced the boys to perform fellatio and then subjected them to sodomy in return for scraps of food and a penny or two to keep them and their families alive. It was a nightmare revelation. And it had occurred a year before, and no one had any information about it. It had occurred in May and June of 2014, and we learned about it in April of 2015, and it became clear that the information about these little boys was being suppressed. So we sat down. This was largely driven by the co-director of AIDS Free World, a woman named Paula Donovan, my co-director. She lives in Boston, and she is tremendous in her analytic and advocacy capacities. And we decided collectively that we should give it to some part of the media that could expose it in a very dramatic and significant way. So we did that. We took it to the Guardian newspaper in the United Kingdom, which is the equivalent in New York, in Europe of the New York Times. And on April 29th of last year, they published the expose of what had been done to these little boys by French peacekeepers, by peacekeepers from one of the Security Council permanent 5 members and one of the leading countries in the world. And of course, all hell broke loose. The range of publicity around Europe was overwhelming, around the world was overwhelming, in the United States, not so much in Canada for reasons that are peculiar. Don't know why it wasn't covered, but everywhere in the world, things went off the rails as people were stunned by what had been done to these little boys a year earlier. And then as word began to get out, it became obvious that it wasn't confined to just those six little boys, that it was a systemic pattern of abuse that was being countenanced in the Central African Republic, and no one, but no one, was reporting it. I mean, when you rape 8 and 9 year old boys and it's documented by 2 major United Nations agencies, you would think that the world would hear about it. But it was all suppressed until we leaked it to The Guardian. And then because we leaked it to The Guardian, more and more attention was paid to AIDS-Free World and our focus on sexual violence. And the reason we had focused on sexual violence in the first instance was because, of course, during the patterns of sexual violence, very often the AIDS virus is transmitted. So there was always a connection with the communicable disease, the pandemic. On May 15th, in New York, we held our press conference to announce the Code Blue campaign. The press conference was anchored at one end by General Romeo Dallaire, the Canadian who was involved, as all of you know, in the Rwandan genocide, led the UN troops, and was anchored at the other end by Grasa Machel, a magnificent African woman who is the widow of Nelson Mandela. So we had a very large press corps, and we had an impressive group of people who absolutely agreed with our analysis, and there was again a great deal of coverage. Having held that press conference, more and more material came before us, and then something happened which was really disheartening. We suddenly realized that there had been a cover-up at the senior levels of the United Nations. How was that possible? I mean, fundamentally, I'm a multilateralist. I was at the United Nations for Canada. I believe in the United Nations. I believe in the agencies. That's what makes one so angry when they don't do their job. And it became clear that at the very highest levels of undersecretaries general involved in the big secretariat and in some of the agencies, they had turned their backs on these kids and on what they knew. And then we were leaked a series of email chains and internal UN statements, which we again gave to the media on May 29th, 1 month after the revelations had been published in the United Kingdom. And again, all hell broke loose as the world began to understand and the countries that are member states of the United Nations began to understand that there was a kind of conspiracy at the top. No one wanted to believe it, but the emails were identifiable. So then what happened, this is almost unprecedented, is that 15 countries went collectively, representing all of the regions of the world, went collectively to the Secretary General and said, if you don't do something, we're going to pass a resolution and force your hand. Now, what pleases me as an advocate about all of this is that throughout the entire piece, AIDS-Free World was commenting. My colleague Paula Donovan was doing hundreds of interviews. We were releasing statements. We were driving this issue in a serious way because we wanted it resolved. And the Secretary General of the United Nations was on the hot seat. He was in terrible difficulty. So on June the 3rd last year, he publicly announced that he would set up a panel of review to look at everything that had happened in the Central African Republic and what was happening throughout the UN system on dealing ineffectively with sexual exploitation and abuse. And on June 22nd, he appointed a panel of 3 to investigate what had occurred. We felt, frankly, triumphant at having moved the United Nations so quickly. Normally, it would take years, but we had managed to push them into action in a matter of months. And the chair of the panel was Madame Justice Marie Deschamps, who is the Canadian judge, formerly on the Supreme Court of Canada, who did the investigation into the Canadian military. So she sat down in the Canadian military's activities on sexual violence. So she sat down with her colleagues. We appeared before her twice formally. I'm not at liberty to say how often there were informal contacts, but we really provided as much evidence and material as we could. And on December 17th, just roughly a month ago, Marie Deschamps tabled her report at the United Nations. It was one of the most striking indictments of the UN that has been published in decades. It called it a gross institutional failure. That was the actual quote. It talked about the way in which the UN was more concerned at senior levels to protecting their own reputation than they were for the lives of the children who had been molested and raped. And they made a number of recommendations. The language was tough and unremitting, and Madame Deschamps simply said, "This is so fragmented, so ridiculous, it's hard to imagine how you could ever deal with it. You keep on talking about zero tolerance for sexual abuse, and look what you have tolerated over the last 15 years. You have report after report after report, and nothing ever changes." She found three senior officials at the most senior levels guilty of abuse of authority, and she named a number of others at the highest level, from the High Commissioner on Human Rights to the Executive Director of UNICEF, as having effectively been delinquent in responding to the dilemma of what was happening. So that came out on December 17th. This is complete coincidence, but later today, AIDS Free World is putting out a statement in response to the Deschamps, one of the recommendations they've made. And in the next few days, the Secretary General will have to give his response. And the whole atmosphere has changed. It's amazing what has happened. But within the United Nations precincts, that's all they're talking about. They're talking about the need to deal with sexual violence. And I mean, we all fight these battles over the years. My mind goes back to endless numbers of battles for social justice, which one engages in. But it's a good feeling, because the United Nations will have to completely reform. The countries are watching. They want to be certain that this comes to an end. And it won't merely be protecting in the future young boys. The protection will apply primarily to women and girls, because they are the targets of sexual predators in peacekeeping operations. And once you break through on peacekeeping operations, and there are 16 major peacekeeping operations, do you know what the United Nations spends on peacekeeping? It spends $8.25 billion a year. And the reputation is being tarred, is being tainted by what has happened in the sexual violence environment. And once you break through on the UN front, then you get countries to start thinking about what's happening in their own jurisdictions and how you have to overcome intimate partnered violence and domestic violence and marital rape and the broad gang rapes and sexual violence, which are endemic to so many countries. And there is a sense then within the international community that the time has come to address this horrific reality in the most direct and forthright of fashions. And that makes it all worthwhile. You can't count the number of women and children who will be saved from rape in the future by virtue of what's been unleashed in the last few months. But you know that there will be numbers of women and children who will live lives that are not destroyed by sexual violence as a result of the metamorphosis and change within the United Nations system. And I want you, all of you in this room, if I may, to feel proud about it, because we couldn't do our work without your support. It's difficult work, but it's so good to be able to say to the world, the trade unions are with us. The social justice dollars that the trade unions spend that support the way in which we can transform and alter social injustice. It's just a joy. I was saying to Mark earlier that I'm with so many non-governmental organizations and charitable institutions, and they say proudly, well, they get money from this corporation and that corporation, and I smile and say, we get money from unions, working people who care about this issue. And I therefore really can't thank you enough. The kinds of things which AIDS Free World is doing, I think I've given you a glimpse of, and that's the pattern of our activities, always taking on the toughest of the issues and refusing to retreat. It's as simple as that. And to know that we are in a community of support and activism that derives from people who have no pretension, who understand the injustice in the world, as you're meeting here in the Sheraton Parkway at Markham, Ontario, in Davos, Switzerland, at the World Economic Forum, the potentates of the multinational corporations are in an incestuous orgy of self-congratulation as they talk about how they're saving the world. And one of the reports which they have just received is from Oxfam International, which was released yesterday, showing that 62 richest people in the world have as much by way of assets as half the world's population. That is to say, 62 of the richest have as much by way of assets and income as 3.5 billion people. So from the point of view of AIDS-Free World, there are still a few mountains to climb and occasional routes to justice. And I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for being so good and generous and supportive of our work.